Yeah, we are going to start with a series of very interesting speakers. And of course, it's good to have the first speaker on stage. That's Albert van Veen. He's from FastID, and his goal is to have a European decentral consumer identity. And according to him, consumers should be back in control about their own data. That's what I heard when I was in Estonia as well. And next to that, there should be secure access for consumers. That's what you are going to talk about. So give a big hand to Albert van Veen.
I will talk today about FastID, and I think it was mentioned before. It's about implementation of the self-sovereign identity, and I think that's really cool. So I'm really happy to be here. I think we're finally moving from a stage of design and all kind of great ideas, and there are great visions in this area, to actual implementations, to make it really happen, and to see in practice how it could help the consumer and the citizens. But before I do that, and of course I started this, my name is Albert van Veen. I worked as a chief information officer for several banks, ING Bank, Moneta Money Bank, a bank in Czech Republic, that one I always need to explain, Schiphol Airport. And they always ask me the question, from why did you start this startup, this new initiative? And of course, the main reason is because it's very cool, and I had totally enough of all the corporate things, the team building days, and other, I don't know, with the different colors, a business area manager, all those. I had enough of it. So I needed to start something for myself, and I wanted to do something that I really liked, and I'm really into the digital identity, and something that is really cool. So I started with this self-sovereign identity. But of course, that is not good enough to explain to the investors and to all the stakeholders you have around you. And they always ask you, what problem are you actually solving? So that question we got over and over again. What problem are you actually solving? I don't think it's always a relevant question. If you think about the iPad, was there an actual problem? Was there something really to solve? Or was it just something that we could do, that we could make? And because the technology was there, it started to be there, and people started to use it. But because I always got that question, and I have not only an English wife, but I also live for a long time in the UK, and I really like British comedians. I thought there is no better way to explain it than this movie, what problem we are actually solving.
And think back now. Now that the internet is so much a part of our lives, think back to our first password, because our minds, our brains, are so filled with passwords. It's such a struggle for us to remember all the passwords. We go to businesses online, and you go, I can't remember my password. And you put it, sometimes they lock you out, and they go, no, you've got one more try to remember your own password, you fucking idiot. Or you click, I forgot it, and they ask you questions about your life, and you don't even remember the answers. They're about your own life. What is your favorite pet? Oh, no, I can't believe I chose one. The dog walks in. If it doesn't me, I'm leaving. I'm literally walking out the door. Oh, the password. And at the beginning, we all had one password. It was our first. Password we can nostalgically remember, and we used it for everything. Every time we joined another business, can I have your password? Yes, you can. That is my special word. And then companies started getting quite rude. You would put your password in, and it would go, weak. Who are you?
It's not my special word.
And they're like, I'm sorry, but the internet has become very popular. We need to strengthen your password. And businesses would insist, we must have from you a capital letter. I'm sorry, we will not be accepting passwords anymore unless it contains at least one capital letter. And we all momentarily considered our options before deciding to capitalize the first letter of our password. And for a period of time, that was fine. But the internet became even more popular. And then businesses started saying, I'm afraid you cannot join unless you have at least one capital letter and at least one number. Again, less than half a microsecond's consideration before we collectively decided you shall be getting the number one, and that would be the end.
So yeah, and this is of course craziness, all those kind of things, and I think it's always really irritating, and it doesn't even stop there, because very often those days as well, you need to prove online that you are not a robot. I mean, yeah, who likes that, proving that you are not a robot? I mean, you are behind a computer and then they ask you to prove that you are not a robot. And I think that is online, so online it's a very kind of big topic to identify yourself with a password, two-factor authentication. I worked for many banks, so you use the two-factor authentication. But if you go offline, it doesn't get a lot better, because I'm going to work. I think I actually have some of those things actually with me. A driver's license you need to take with you. I'm in a hotel because I live in the Czech Republic, so you get a plastic card to open the door. A badge to go to your work to prove who you are. A car key to open the car. I go swimming with my daughter. You need a plastic pulse wrist belt to show who you are. To the gym, a plastic pass, so it's a total, and at the end when you go to home very often, you need the key to open the door to show that the house is actually yours. So the whole journey of identification online, offline, at services, it's a total disaster, and we created a complete mess of keys, pass, people with wallets in them. It's a very, very complex journey. So the problem that we are actually solving is that the online and the offline identification, it's very old-fashioned. And I believe we are in the time that we can change that, that we can make that a lot better. And I think the mission of FastID is that. It's time to have the change over there. And if you need to identify yourself, if you think about it, I worked for ING Bank and Moneta Money Bank. It's very odd that to prove who you are, you have a plastic bank pass and you need to remember a number. And even when you go to the branch, you need to prove who you are with a pass. And I mean, you are there. And the pass and the number, the PIN number, it all came there as something in between to identify yourself. But those days, it's totally not needed anymore. And people talk about chips. And shall I do a chip in my skin? But why? And why not use something for identification that I've always with you? And that is your biometrics. Could be your face, could be your voice. And it's something that you can never forget. It's something that can never be empty, that you never have to charge. It's always with you. So that's what FastID is. FastID is a decentral digital identity. It's an implementation of the self-sovereign identity. And it's something that you store on your own mobile phone. And it's something that you can use to quickly get access. And I think that is the most important. How do we use it? It's something that you can use to quickly get access to services, to locations, and to events. And as you should have with a decentral identity, it's stored on your own mobile phone. And it's only stored on your own mobile phone. And of course, we looked at solutions as well to store it somewhere centrally. Yeah? So that if you lose your mobile phone, you still have it somewhere in the cloud. So you could store it in a secure area of your own iCloud, or somewhere where it is saved safely at a central location. But we didn't go that way. We say it's on your own mobile phone, it's on the secure area of your own mobile phone, and if you lose your phone, you also lose your identity and you will have to make it again. Because we believe decentral is decentral, and something that is from you, it's from you, and then you trust nobody except yourself. So if you look at it, because this is about self-sovereign identity in action, how does it work? And because they're all experts, of course they're all experts here in the audience, so I will explain it quite quick. This is Michiel said, it's about the quality of the audience. Unfortunately, we have all experts here. But this is in a, as you would say in Dutch, in a notendop, in a summary, how it works with the digital identity of FastID. You have an identity card, a passport, it has a chip. Well, in most countries, it has a chip. In some countries, I live now in the Czech Republic, the identity cards don't have, not all identity cards have an active chip, near-field communication chip. So then you need to make photos, and you can do it with optical character recognizing. But in principle, we work with the near-field communication chip. So you make a copy and paste. That's kind of what it is. Eh? So everything happens only on the mobile phone. Nothing leaves the mobile phone. Eh? So the check if it is a valid digital signature, if it is issued by a country, everything is happening on the mobile phone. And you make a copy paste to your own mobile phone. And with that, of course, you also take the high resolution photo that is on the chip. And again, you store that as well on your mobile phone. Now, then to be sure that it is me, you do a verification check. So you do the selfie before it was already discussed about the deep fake. So, of course, your selfie needs to be interactive. And you need to have several checks that it is not a deep fake that you are experiencing. I always think the best test for the deep fake, of course, is when you have a real online use case. Yeah? Because a deep fake you can do online. But yeah, the moment you go to the airport, the deepfake fails. Yeah? So to reuse a digital identity, I think has many benefits. Because a deepfake you can only use online. Yeah? The deepfake, yeah, if you go to the gym, you can hardly come there as a deepfake. So you make a copy and paste, you have your photo, and from then on you can use your photo, your biometric, for identification. So wherever you go, to the airport, to the gym, instead of using a code, a pass, and a QR code, you can identify yourself with your face. There's nothing you need to get anymore, and you can just walk through the door, and you can access the service. And I think there is something magic about using your biometrics to access a physical service, because in a way it's kind of strong identification at location. Eh? That's what you do. It's not two-factor. Eh? Banks very often use two-factor. Here you use strong authentication with biometrics. But there is something really magic about it. And we did the experiment at Schiphol with the Schiphol board. And some of the members, they were a little bit critical. They said, okay, but I have my ticket and I have my passport. And what is wrong with that? And why am I not? Why is that not good enough? And so we made a test environment where we invited the whole board to come. And I will never forget that the chairman of the Schiphol board then, which is a different than the one now, who is leaving as well, but it's a bit longer time ago. And he was coming over there, and he was busy, and he was walking with his bag in his hand, and he had a telephone call, and he always said, okay, I don't know, I like my ticket, I like my passport, and he was approaching the gate, because we built a gate, and when you are approaching the gate, you get stress in your head, because, gate, there's something that I need to show, is it a passport, is it a ticket, is it a QR code, and you get stress. Same as when you're at the airport, you are with children, they're basically running around, so your hands are full and you don't have the time to watch in your phone for a QR code, to open your e-wallet. And he was approaching the gate and he came there and you saw the stress in his head and the gate opened. And when you come somewhere and you're recognized and the gate opens automatically, everybody smiles. Everybody that goes through walks with a big smile and they say, hey, I'm recognized, they know it's me and I'm welcome. Yeah, so it's really a very nice experience to do that. Yeah, sometimes people think, okay, is it not a bit scary with your own biometrics? But the moment you do it, it's a really, really nice and cool experience to do it. Now, then what it is all about, the self-sovereign identity in practice. And I think that what we see as a startup, so we use the self-sovereign identity for online, so we offer that as a service as well. But we see especially a big demand for the services in the offline, because I think a lot of the companies, the startups, the fintechs, they're all focusing on the online and they're all focusing on the financial institutions. But there are also great use cases in just the offline, in the physical world. So for hotels, it's very very strange that you still get a plastic card to open the door and you still need to go to reception and fill in a guest form and put a signature over there. So there are many ways how you can do that better, how you can improve that with a digital identity. Airports, of course, an example that I will show in a minute, a little movie from stadiums and events, especially where now, what you see in a lot of stadiums, they're struggling with vandalism and with racism. And yeah, by entering with a digital identity, it will not only make it easier for the supporters to get in, but you also create possibilities to check if people are basically behaving as they should behave and don't destroy things or say racist things. Fitness, public transport, banks, So there are really many cases, and some of them, because it is about self-sovereign identity in practice, I will show right now, and starting with the one that we implemented as the first with FastID, and that's the Rotterdam Fast Track. Rotterdam is part of the Schiphol group. Schiphol, I worked there for 5 years, has a very strong and conservative data privacy policy, so they are very, very careful in using biometrics. You can see that when you are a premium user, you can see that they replaced a lot of the eye recognition now with only the card check, because they say, okay, we only want to use biometrics for the border control, because you need to have an important reason to use the biometrics. The other, in the others, like the lounge, we don't think it's a strong reason. So we were sitting, I think the implementation of the FastID in Rotterdam took about 2 or 3 weeks. But to get the agreement with the data privacy officers, it took about three months. And on one hand, you could say that is difficult as a startup when you need to go through all those data privacy questions. I think on the other hand, it's brilliant, because it really made our product stronger. It really made it ready for other airports as well. And it showed to me that the title of the conference is decentralized identities and databases. It shows to me that the world really needs to get used to decentral identities. I work myself as a CIO from Schiphol and ING, always with central databases. So everybody understands the central concept. It's not a good concept, I believe. I think it is a very weak concept, but everybody knows it. So the data privacy officers from Schiphol, they had loads of questions for a centralized database. So you are a data processor, so we need a data processing agreement, but we are not a data processor as a decentralized identity. Because as FastID, none of our staff can access the data of people who make the decentralized identity. We are really not able to see the data because we don't have the key. But the data privacy officers from Schiphol, they ask us questions like, how do you make sure that all your staff is screened so they cannot see the data in your central database? But we don't have a central database. We have no access to the data. So the implementation, and that's also one of the nice things of a decentralized identity, is very easy. It's very fast. I was talking with the IT director from Rotterdam Airport, and she was sitting there thinking, I have a huge project. We're going to make a big database in a secure area, demilitarized zone, GDPR. And there was nothing, because it's a decentralized database. The database is there already. And so everything we needed from the IT department was power and internet, and that's it, and we were ready to go. Well, and 3 months data privacy assessment. But this is the...
At Rotterdam, The Hague Airport, you can now quickly and easily access our security filter and Prima Vista lounge. This is possible with the new technology, FastID. If you reserve a parking space online at our P1 or P2 parking lots, you can use the FastID app to access the Fast Track and other services at the Rotterdam The Hague Airport. With the FastID app, you can quickly and easily create your own digital identity from home, after which you can identify yourself with your face and make use of the Fast Track services at our airport, allowing you to travel faster and more comfortably. With FastID, you have quick and easy access to our security filter or Prima Vista lounge, so you don't have to stand in line. FastID gives access by using digital identity and facial recognition. This is a new way to provide faster access. Want to know more about FastID? Check out our website.
Right, so I will quickly go to the next use case and then see if there are any questions as well, because I'm talking a lot, I realize. But I think this is a very good one, because we're all talking about wallets, we're all talking about decentral identity, and who will do it? Will it be the European community? Will it be the countries? Will they select a big supplier to make that identity? Will it be Apple? Will it be Google? I don't think so, by the way, because those companies, they want to know everything of you. I think a proper identity company wants to know nothing of you. They want to know as little as possible from you, and they make it possible for a consumer citizen to communicate directly with the merchant. They're not in between. But I think even more important than that is, how do you make the connection to a business area? Because when I was finished with the bank, I said, I'm going to do something else. And I showed to Johannes Shushu, our first client in Czech Republic, he has a hotel. And I came to him and I said, I have a digital identity. I show how it works. You scan the NFC chip, you do the selfie, you're ready in 20 seconds, ready to go. And he said, yeah, but what the hell? Probably the best way to say it. I don't need a digital identity. I need a digital check-in. And I said, okay, but that I don't have. I have a digital identity. And then you start to think, okay, how can I integrate a digital identity in a certain business area? And for a hotel, yeah, what you need on top of your identity is a guest form. And you need to sign the guest form. So then in the app, you need to create a guest form and you need to be able to put a signature in. And then what they do at a hotel, so they check your identity. So they check your identity document. And then they start working in the system. They say, okay, what room do we have? We give you room 221. And they give you that plastic card. Van der Valk here, plastic card. So we had to make that ready in the phone. So the allocation of the room is online, is digital. The plastic card is replaced by the phone. So you get basically the card as well on your phone. And then the room is allocated the night before. When the room is clean, the key is activated. You go to your hotel room, you put your phone against the door. It checks your face so that it is really Albert van Veen who's in the hotel. So the identity check is not done at reception. It's done at the hotel door. And then the door opens. So the hotel also knows exactly who's in the room. Well, they know who opened the door. They don't know who's in, but they know who opened. While in the current process, they only know who's at reception. So if I make a damage, or I can always say, yeah, I lost my card and someone else opened it. Now that is over, but the thing is, it's not so easy to integrate a digital identity in a certain business area. Because for this, we had to integrate with Oracle, the Oracle Hotel PMS. We had to integrate with Meus, which is another hotel PMS. So yeah, I think the digital identity question, in a way, is the most simple. It's very easy. Very easy. It's not complicated anymore to create a digital identity. And when the European digital identity will come, or the European wallet, yeah, for us it would be perfect, because it would make it easy to integrate it to certain business areas. And yeah, that is the same for every business area where you look at, I think. It is nowhere that you can just say, okay, I have a digital identity, go ahead. Yeah, so another example is the gyms, where you need to integrate with the gym PMS to make sure you can integrate. Now, before I go to the last bit, are there any kind of questions or remarks about the use cases? I think remarks is a bit dangerous in this group of experts, because you probably have all kinds of things that I cannot answer. But
yeah, thank you, Albert. So I'm wondering, with the biometrics, you're also transferring them for passportless check-in, etc. So what do you share? Do you share the picture that you got from the document ID document or some kind of template?
So it's encrypted. It's an encrypted hash that you share, but you don't always share it. The hotel use case, you share it with no one because it's on your own camera. So nobody gets your biometric, only yourself. The Rotterdam use case, the access system that you saw is from FastID. So there is basically, the only thing that leaves your phone then is an encrypted version of your face that goes to a camera of FastID, by the way, which we can also not access, so nobody can access it. And then you walk to the camera, your face is directly encrypted, and the two encryptions are compared. And the moment you walk through, it's deleted again. So with Rotterdam, we didn't share any data. Rotterdam is getting zero data, but you could also choose for a system.
So it's hash templates then?
Sorry?
It's hash templates for Rotterdam.
Yeah, but not with Rotterdam Airport. And so Rotterdam Airport itself doesn't get any data. The only thing that they get is the green light that you saw. That's the only data that Rotterdam gets.
That's good.
Any other questions?
Remarks? Critical remarks? No? Then we quickly go to the last.
You do have a question?
You have a question?
You cannot record yourself, but...
What if you injure your face badly?
Yeah, so I love that question. So we had Rico Verhoeven, the boxer. So when you can, we also did a test, by the way, on Tim and Tom Coronel. Yeah, with those things, it doesn't. So if you are too damaged, you have to use another biometric. And you always have a fallback with a QR code. And I get that question quite often for the gym. So you show the gym. And then they say, yeah, but what if you, because we have with the gym, we have 2D cameras. We don't have the 3D. You can do 3D. We use them as well. Then you have the real liveness check at location. Here we use the 2D. And then people say, yeah, but what if you come with a photo? But yeah, imagine, I mean, you see the reception, someone is sitting over there, eh? You want to go to the gym, and you're walking there with the photo. You're walking in like this, eh? Into the gym, and they, someone is telling, what are you doing? Shh! I'm trying to get into the gym to save 15 euros. So yeah, you can do everything. You can do a second biometric with a fingerprint, but it depends on the use case, what you develop, and how far you want to go.
Thank you.
It was the first time I got a question from the cameraman. I think that's brilliant.
Well, I can explain. I sometimes film at metal festivals. Ah. And one time, some drunk guy fell, and he was really tall, and he fell in my face.
Ah. So
my face got injured. It was a bloody mess. Yeah. So yeah, I didn't look the same.
You had the practical. I do think, by the way, the most interesting thing talking about metal concepts is, for example, the stadium where we look at, where they are considering, do we make it free, or is it going to be an obligation to use your face? But I think the most interesting thing is the effect on the brain of people. The moment you are personally responsible for what you do, you start to act different. If I'm alone in a stadium, I'm not going to break down a chair. Or I'm not going to shout bad thing about people that have another color. You only do that when you are in a group and you know you are not responsible for what you do. And of course, there's something to say for that, but there is also something to say for the other case. That when you come in somewhere and you break down something, yeah, then you are responsible for it. Albert, right, I see you at the time.
I'm looking at the time, Albert.
So I will not do this slide. So unless there are any other questions, then I can do quickly the slide, but I think you are
One last question here.
Yeah, so you talked about the implementation is quite easy, but the use cases that you talk about, like with hotels, airports, they usually have like bespoke custom applications for their own environments. Some of them might have APIs, but I guess most of them won't. So what is your expertise, or like how do you approach these kind of projects from the customer side, and what is their requirement in implementing this solution?
So I think it's the experience till now, because I explained the example with the first hotel where I came. I said, okay, I have a digital identity. I say, yeah, I need a digital check-in. And then we looked at their hotel PMS, and they were using Oracle Opera. I don't know how much experience you all have with Oracle. I guess a lot. And then it's complex, because you need to get a partnership with Oracle. And for Oracle, we are eeny, peeny, mini mouse. So the first question was, do you have more than 500 employees? No. At that moment, we had three employees. So it took a long time before we got a partnership with Oracle, and that we are now integrated. And now the next hotel that have is nothing. They have hardly any cost because we already have the integration. And then the second hotel that we saw was Meos. It's a new hotel system. It's basically the same as the gym systems. They're completely open within 2 weeks, and they like you to have an integration. They have API shops, and within 2 weeks you're ready. And then hardware-wise, it's if they have the new locks, for example, in a hotel, it's nothing. For Rotterdam Airport, the implementation costs were around something like 2,500 euro for the whole airport. Well, we have only one touchpoint security, so the other touchpoint will be the same. Or the lounge we have as well, so that would be 5,000 euro then. Every touchpoint is around 2,500 euro. While when you would have a central database, it would be 10 times that. I always worked with central database, but now I see the power of decentralized database. As well as a hacker, I started my career for audit as a hacker. You're always looking for the big databases, like the Previum database, it's central. If I get it, I have much of information. Well, yeah, if I hack the decentral identity of Albert van Veen after 2 years, I've won one identity. So it doesn't make sense. So the design of a decentral identity and a decentral database, I love it. It's a shame I spent so much time with central databases before in my career.
But it is very nice to have compliance policies that you know.
Sorry?
I don't know if you have any good, but if I can apply on your behalf, then it's good. Not so good for security.
No, but good for the revenue. No, I'm joking. No, but how do you mean? I don't get it. Because this, for example, what you see right now, for example, your boarding pass, the way it's checked, I can give my boarding pass to you. By the way, my Previum pass, I could check to you, and you could use it, because there is no check if it is really you flying. And so with checks like this, and you can check as far as you want. You can use, okay, just do you have a ticket, but you can also check your identity. Is your identity matched with your boarding pass? So then I know for sure that you are Albert van Veen in the security area or not.
And then it's not replacing your identity document, but only your
ticket. Yeah. So very often we have FastID as a ticket. And then it's just the effect of, instead of showing all kind of documents, it...
It's good to see a lot of discussion, a lot of questions.
Yes.
Albert, I guess you are here all morning, aren't
yes,
you?
Correct.
So we also have a short break, of course, after several other people who are going to talk. So give a big hand to Albert van Veen for his first presentation.